That's perfect. Thanks. So, very good afternoon to all of you. So, my name is Vijayanand. On behalf of the Institute, I welcome all of you to the Foundation Day lecture at ISER Mohali. And I take this opportunity to thank our chief guest, Professor Ramesh Sonthi from ISER Tirupati for accepting our invitation to deliver the Foundation Day lecture and also for coming here all the way from Tirupati. Thank you, Professor Sonthi. So now I request the chief guest, Professor Sonthi, and the director, Professor Gaur Shankar, and the deputy director, Professor Sudeshna Sanha, to come on the stage and then take seat, please. Thank you. Now I request Dr. Rachna Chaba, the Associate Dean R&D, to hand over the bouquet to the chief guest, Professor Sonthi. Thank you, Dr. Chaba. So now I invite Professor Gauri Shankar, the director of ISER Mohali, to give the welcome address and also to kindly introduce the chief guest. So before starting the lecture, the annual report for the year 2020-21 will be officially released by the chief guest. So Professor Gauri Shankar.
Thank you, Dr. Vijayanath, Professor Ramesh Sonthi, Professor Sudeshna Sinha, and members in the audience. It gives me great pleasure today to invite all of you on this occasion of the ISER Mohali Foundation Day. We are today 15 years old. Formally, the institute began or was conceived and was initiated in the year 2006. And classes for the undergraduate students, BSMS students, started in 2007. So the year 15 marks an important milestone for all of us, and we intend, COVID pandemic permitting, to have a series of events to mark this year, starting from today till September 27th, 2022. This is also the first public occasion since the pandemic began 18 months ago, where we thought it safe enough with COVID protocols and precautions in place to have an in-person lecture. And to this, I am extremely grateful to Professor Ramesh Sonthi, who readily agreed to travel to Mohali from Tirupati to deliver his lecture here. For the sake of those who haven't been able to come to the campus physically present today, we have also made arrangements for a hybrid presentation. So the lecture is being streamed online for those who wish to listen to the lecture but are unable to come here. Fortunately or unfortunately, today is also the day of the National Bandh. And this bandh has severely impacted many institutions, including ours. Many of our faculty and students who were otherwise keen to be here to interact with Professor Ramesh Sonthi and hear his lecture are unable to do so physically, but they would be doing so online. The coincidence is that the topic of Professor Ramesh Sonthi's lecture today is very much tied to the interests of the farmers of the country, and especially the farmers of Punjab. So as you will listen to his talk, you will see how the work that his group has done has been extremely important in increasing the yields of the staple rice cereal food, which is one of the most important crops of Punjab as well. To introduce Professor Ramesh Sonthi to all of you, I will begin by saying that he and I have had a very close professional association for nearly 30 years, ever since Ramesh joined the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, where I was, in 1993. Prior to that, Ramesh had done his graduation from Andhra University in Visakhapatnam, his post-graduation and MPhil from the University of Hyderabad, and in all places, his was a brilliant academic career. He then proceeded to the USA to obtain his PhD in bacterial genetics from the University of Utah. And this was studying with model organisms, but subsequently he has chosen to move into the plant science field and has been working on a bacterial pathogen of rice for the last 30 years. They have made several remarkable discoveries, but the most satisfying aspect of it all is that these discoveries in basic science have led to translational efforts that have been equally successful. And I will leave it to Ramesh to explain their story over the last three decades. These findings from his group have led to several important recognitions for Professor Ramesh Sonthi. He is an elected fellow of the Indian National Science Academy, the Indian Academy of Science, and the National Academy of Sciences in India. He is the recipient of the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, as well as the National Bioscience Award of the Department of Biotechnology. For the work that has led to the translation of their basic research, he has received the CSIR Award for Innovation in Rural Development and the Process and Product Award of the Department of Biotechnology. One remarkable or unusual feature of his career that I can share with you is that each year there are 5 to 10 Bhatnagar awardees across the disciplines, and as I said, he's one of them. But there is a very much smaller number of people who can claim to be a Bhatnagar awardee and be the mentor of a student who in turn has gone ahead to receive the Bhatnagar Award. And Ramesh belongs to one of them. His first student, or his second or third student, Dr. Shubhadeep Chatterjee, was the recipient of the Bhatnagar Award last year. So with that, I would again welcome Professor Ramesh to our midst today on this occasion of the Foundation Day, as we look forward to the lecture that he is to give to us. Thank you. We shall now have, as Dr. Vijayanand said, the release of the annual report by our chief guest.
Thank you, Professor Gaurishankar. So now I request the chief guest, Professor Ramesh Sonthi, to officially release the annual report. I also request Professor Gaurishankar and Professor Sudeshna to join him. Thanks. Thank you very much, Professor Sonthi, Professor Gaurishankar, and Professor Sinha. Thank you. So now I invite the chief guest, Professor Ramesh Sonthi, to deliver the Foundation Day lecture. I request Professor Gaurishankar and Professor Sinha to take their seats in the lecture hall. Thank you very much. Professor Sonthi.
Good afternoon, everybody, and my special thanks to Professor Gaurishankar and ISER Mohali for inviting me to give this 15th Foundation Day lecture. It's a real pleasure for me to be here and share this wonderful and joyous occasion with all of you. I've seen ISER Mohali grow from, very, very, from the very beginning, essentially when this new campus was being set up, I used to visit the Navi campus when it was in its transient campus, and we would come over here to visit all of these institutes that are there in this region. And it's fantastic to see ICER Mohali do so well. And along with ICER Mohali, all of the other institutes, Navi, SIAB, and the Indian School of Business, all of them have come up so well. And it's a real pleasure for me to be back here in Mohali, in this wonderful Tri-City region. I think this region is very promising, and it has emerged as one of the leading places for doing science and technology within the country. So today's lecture, as Shankar was saying, it's a journey of at least a couple of decades, at least 20 years, and I'll begin with this picture that I took when we had gone with my family to the Andaman Islands on, you know, those of you who are faculty would know something called leave travel concession. And this island in the Andaman, this particular beach in Andaman Islands is characterized by these large stands of trees, lush green, in a very tropical environment. And what I want to draw your attention to is that these plants are exposed to the environment. Every day, thousands, maybe millions of microbes land on these trees. And the conditions are ideal for these microbes to thrive on these plants, because temperature is high, humidity is very optimal. So microbes can actually thrive there. But as you can see, all these plants are lush green. You know, they stay free from disease. So how do these plants manage to ward off the pathogens? That is the story that I will tell you about, a story of a 20-year story. And the work on development of the disease-resistant variety has been going in parallel along with these studies. As Professor Gauri Shankar was mentioning, we look at the interaction between rice and this bacterial pathogen called Xanthomonas oryzae pathover oryzae, or XOO. XOO causes a disease called bacterial blight, which is a serious rice disease. It's a serious disease in many parts of India, including in Punjab. And there's a Punjab connection to our work on development of disease-resistant rice variety that I'll tell you a little bit later. So we look at the interaction between rice and XOO, and we use that as a model to study how plants ward off pathogens and how pathogens try to overcome plant defenses. So I'll overview. I've divided my talk into three broad sections. In the very beginning, I'll give you a very brief overview of the plant innate immune system, because I realize that many in the audience may not be familiar with this. And then I will talk to you about how rice immunity is modulating during bacterial infection, both by the plant and by the bacterium. And finally, I will talk to you about our work on development of the bacterial disease-resistant rice variety. So there are the plant, I mean, we think of plants as sessile organisms, you know, maybe not very responsive to environmental changes, but that's far from the truth. Plants are, in terms of the biomass on our planet, they constitute 80% of the biomass on our planet. And that in itself is a testament to how successful their lifestyle has been. And the success of this lifestyle is dependent on the ability of plants to fight off infection. And how they fight infection is that there are two layers of the plant immune system, and I will describe both of them a little bit later, what is the evidence for these, but I will just give you a summary of what these two layers actually accomplish. The first layer of the plant immune system is, constitutes receptors that are present at the cell surface of plant cell. So every plant cell has these receptors, and every plant cell can mount this defense response. And these receptors that are there at the cell surface, they detect extracellular signals. So signals that come from outside the plant, that indicate to the plant that there is a pathogen around. So how does the plant determine when a pathogen is around? It determines that by looking at one of two different kinds of signals. One particular category of signals are what are called pathogen-associated molecular patterns, or they are also called PAMPs. What are these pathogen-associated molecular patterns? There is a molecule called flagellin. Now, flagellin is part of the bacterial flagellar apparatus. The bacterial flagellar apparatus helps the bacterium swim. So all bacteria that can swim have flagella. And what plants have done is that they have learned to recognize a certain portion of this flagellin molecule. They have a receptor that detects this flagellin molecule. And once that receptor interacts with flagellin, that is a signal to the plant that a microbe is around. You know, flagellin normally should not be there, within the plant. But if it's there outside the plant cell, it means that there's a microbe there. And that is an indicator to the plant that, there's an imminent invasion and it has to mount a defense response. Like flagellin, there's another molecule called lipopolysaccharide that is present on the outer membrane of all gram-negative bacteria. Again, plants can detect these lipopolysaccharide. Like that, people are discovering more and more such molecules that are what are called pattern molecules that are present on, that are secreted by microbes, and their presence actually indicates to the plant that a microbe is around. So whenever a PAMP is detected by a cognate receptor in the plant plasma membrane, so these signals are outside, the plant mounts a defense response. The second category of molecules are what are called damage-associated molecular patterns. So these are molecules that are released from plant cells when the plant is, when a microbial infection is on. So microbial infection damages the plant cell, and that results in release of certain constituents that are normally inside the plant. Now these constituents come out into the extracellular space, and the moment these are outside, the neighboring plant cells have receptors to detect these molecules, and these are what are called damage-associated molecular patterns. And again, the damage-associated molecular patterns are an indication that an imminent invasion is underway. And one category of damage-associated molecules that I'm going to talk about are cell wall degradation products. So the plant cells have cell walls, and that cell wall is damaged by microbial attack, and cell wall degradation products are released, and that is an indication of, again, an attack that is underway. Together, PAMP and DAMP-triggered immunity is referred to as pathogen-triggered immunity, or PTI. So the first layer is what is called pathogen-triggered immunity, and it recognizes signals that are outside the cell. So these receptors recognize extracellular signals. There's a second layer of the plant immune system, and again, both of these I will discuss more and more as we go along. This second layer consists of receptors that are intracellular. So they recognize the signal that has come into the plant cell, and they mount a defense response, and this is triggered by effectors that are secreted into host cells by the pathogen. So the pathogen, as part of its pathogenesis process, secretes certain molecules, often these are proteins, into plant cells. And then there are receptors that are inside the plant cell that recognize these effectors. Again, that is a signal to the plant that it is under attack and it has to mount a defense response. And this second layer is what is called effector-triggered immunity. And during the course of my talk, I will discuss with you the evidence for this first layer of the defense response and a second layer of the defense response. So PTI and ETI in the interaction between rice and this bacterial pathogen. So just to give you a simplified scheme for how the first layer of the plant innate immune system works, and this is what I'll be talking about for most of my presentation today. This is the plasma membrane of the plant cell, and this is the receptor that is present in the plasma membrane, and it recognizes an elicitor. This elicitor, as I said, can be flagellin, can be a cell wall degradation product, can be lipopolysaccharide, can be various other molecules, and people are discovering more and more of these elicitors as they keep studying how plants and pathogens interact with each other. Now, the binding of the elicitor to the receptor, often, it's not always the case, but most of these signaling pathways involve a receptor kinase. Kinases are proteins that put a phosphate group onto substrates. So this receptor kinase gets activated, and there is a phosphorylation event of a target protein, and that sets off a signal relay. Once that signal relay starts, that ultimately ends up in the activation of what are called transcription factors. Transcription factors are proteins that turn on expression of plant genes, and these plant genes encode proteins that are involved in defense. So once these transcription factors are activated, a defense response is elaborated by the plant, and there is resistance. So this is how the first layer of the plant immune system works. There is a receptor that recognizes an extracellular signal, starts off a signal transduction cascade that is often involved in phosphorelay, but there are other signaling molecules, signaling pathways also. So this signal transduction ultimately results in activation of a transcription factor. And once the transcription factor is activated, the defense response is induced and there is resistance. So this is sort of a brief overview of the plant innate immune system that I have given you. Now I will move on to talk to you a little bit, talk to you about our work on the modulation of rice immunity during bacterial infection. So when this bacterium infects rice, how is the immune response activated? How is it modulated by the bacterium? This is what we will discuss. So as I told you earlier, the plant cell has a cell wall, and many of you heard, probably read about this in high school biology, that a major difference between animal cells and plant cells is the presence of a cell wall. It's often composed of a variety of polysaccharides. These cell walls actually cover the entire plant cell, and the nutrients that the microbe is seeking are actually locked inside. So the cell wall forms as a jacket that prevents access of the microbe to the nutrients that are inside the plant cell. So many years ago, one of my PhD students, his name is Suvendra Kumar Ray, and he is a faculty member at Tezpur University. He had started this work. I hope you can see at the back, this bacterium secretes a variety of cell wall degrading enzymes. So the rice cell wall is composed, as I said, of polysaccharides, and these can be cellulose, these can be what is called pectin, these can be xylan. So different polysaccharides and certain proteins constitute the cell wall of the plant. And what Suvendra actually showed is that these bacterium secrete cell wall degrading enzymes, and that these are very important virulence factors for the bacterium. So if you inactivate through mutation these cell wall degrading enzymes, they have an effect on the virulence of the bacterium. So together, these cell wall degrading enzymes constitute a very, very important component of the arsenal of this bacterium to cause disease on rice. So you can imagine that there is a wall that surrounds the plant cell, and that wall has to be breached if the microbe has to cause disease. And that breaching is done by these cell wall degrading enzymes. So this was Suvendra's work, PhD thesis work. There was a scientist, her name was Dr. Rajeshwari Ramanan. She had actually worked on a different aspect. Now, while we were doing this work, we were aware of some work that had been done in the 1980s in the United States by a very famous biochemist called Peter Albersheim. And what Professor Peter Albersheim and his group showed, that they were working on a fungal pathogen of soybean. And what they showed was that the fungal pathogen secretes a cell wall degrading enzyme. And this cell wall degrading enzyme, when it acts on fungal cell walls, there are cell wall degradation products that are released. And these cell wall degradation products induce immune responses, defense responses in soybean cells. So we had these cell wall degrading enzymes on our hand. And what Dr. Rajeshwari Ramanan did was, she wanted to find out if in rice we are using different enzymes, not using the same kind of enzymes that the soybean group was working on, Professor Peter Albersheim's group was working on, but nevertheless they are cell wall degrading enzymes. So we wanted to know whether these cell wall degrading enzymes, when you treat rice plants with them, would they also elicit immune responses? And what Dr. Rajeshwari Ramanan and Gopalji Jha, another PhD student in my lab, they actually showed that these cell wall degrading enzymes, the purified cell wall degrading enzymes, induce very, very potent responses. So the cell wall degrading enzyme acts on rice, and that rice plant actually now mounts a defense response. And these are very, very potent defense responses. How potent they are, I'll show you in a subsequent slide. So this caused a puzzle for us. These same enzymes that are required for causing disease are actually eliciting immune responses in the rice plant. And these immune responses can actually protect the plants against subsequent disease by the pathogen. So how does the Exobacteria manage to overcome this particular problem? And what Gopalji thought is that the bacterium should be able to suppress these defense responses. So there are cell wall degrading enzymes that the bacterium secretes. They mount a defense response. And what Gopalji reasoned is that the bacterium should be able to suppress them. That is why it is able to cause disease. So what Gopalji did was he took these cell wall degrading enzymes and he mixed them with the XOO bacterium. So if you treat cell wall degrading enzyme alone, that mounts a defense response. But if you take the cell wall degrading enzyme along with the bacterium, there is no defense response induced. So very clearly, Gopalji was able to demonstrate that, yes, there is a suppression of plant-innate immunity. So there are two PhD students and an institute scientist who set up the stage for everything else that we have done subsequently. Suvendra's work showing that these enzymes are very important for virulence. Dr. Rajeshwari Ramanan's work showing that they are inducing defense responses, and Gopalji's work showing that the bacterium can suppress these immune responses. So how does the bacterium suppress these immune responses? I won't go into the details of all the experiments that Gopalji did, but suffice to say that what Gopalji showed is that this XOO bacterium uses a particular protein secretion system. See, bacteria have a number of different protein secretion systems. You can think of these protein secretion systems as molecular machines that take cargo from inside the bacterial cell and secrete them outside. So there are a variety of these molecular machines. Each one picks up a different kind of cargo. And there's a signal for that. You don't need to worry about how all of that works. Just think that there is one particular secretion system, and that secretion system takes proteins from within the bacterial cell and introduces them directly into plant cells. So that is the important component. This protein secretion system is like a needle. It injects proteins from within the bacterial cell and into rice cells. And what Gopalji showed is that this bacterium uses the type 3 secretion system. It secretes some proteins. We didn't know at that time what these proteins were. It secretes them directly into plant cells, and that secretion is necessary for the bacterium to be able to suppress rice innate immunity. So what we do know now is that the bacterium secretes certain cell wall degrading enzymes, they induce immune responses, and the bacterium is able to suppress them using some proteins that it secretes through the type 3 secretion system. Now, what is this immune response like? Now, I don't know whether people in the back can actually see it. What I am showing you here, this is a rice leaf. And this is an enzyme called cellobiosidase, which is one of the enzymes secreted by the XOO bacterium to cause disease on rice. And we've taken the purified cellobiosidase enzyme, injected it a little bit into the midvein of the rice leaves. So this is the midvein of the rice leaves. We inject the cellobiocide enzyme into the midvein, and into another set of rice leaves, we inject just the buffer in which that cell wall degrading enzyme is present. And all of these rice leaves, we subsequently inoculate them with the XOO bacterium. So one set of leaves have been treated with the cellobiocidase enzyme, another set of leaves have been treated with a buffer. These are the controls. And the buffer-treated rice leaves, if you can actually see them, I don't know how clear it is from the back, but there is actually a browning that occurs. And that lesion is actually spreading down the rice leaf, down all the way to the tip of the leaf. So what is actually happening is, this is the normal infection symptom. But if you look at the rice leaf that is treated with the cell wall degrading enzyme, and they have also been infected with the same bacteria, disease doesn't progress. Even if it progresses, the lesions are very, very, very minimal. So this is a clear case where by treatment with a cell wall degrading enzyme, we are able to immunize rice against subsequent infection by the pathogen. So what this shows is that this is an inducible immune system. It's not a preformed immune response. This immune response is being elicited in response to treatment with the cell wall degrading enzyme. Now, this is a functional assay where we are showing that if you treat with a cell wall degrading enzyme, certain responses are induced that actually confer enhanced tolerance or resistance to the bacteria. So there are a variety of readouts for immune responses in plants. We have tried out all of these, and in all of them, treatment with the cell wall degrading enzyme elicits those immune responses. And only one such response I'm going to tell you about now, because I will discuss this a little bit later in subsequent slides. So this is a rice leaf that is infiltrated with a buffer, and this is a rice leaf that is infiltrated with, again, that same cellobiocidase enzyme. And I want to draw your attention to these bright spots that are present on this leaf that is treated with the cell wall degrading enzyme that are either absent or very much reduced in the buffer-treated leaves. These bright spots are actually staining for a particular compound called callose. Callose is a polysaccharide that is produced in plant cells as part of the defense response. See, what happens is, when the microbe attacks the cell wall and causes damage to it, the plant senses that and it deposits callose at that particular point. So think about it. You have a house, there is a wall, and somebody is trying to break down that wall. What you are doing from the inside is trying to fortify that wall by putting additional components there to cover that hole. So that is what callose deposits do. Additionally, the callose deposits have very, it's believed that they have very potent antimicrobial compounds, so that not only do they shore up the wall, but they are also antimicrobial in nature. So this is a standard response of the plant innate immune system to microbial infection. So the take-home message of this slide is that plants have powerful inducible immune responses that are triggered upon, in this case, cell wall damage. Similar results you can see if you treat with flagellin or other things. So this is what the first layer of the plant immune system can actually do. So the next point for us was that, yes, plants have immune responses that are induced, and I also told you that XOO suppresses them using the type 3 secretion system. So what we decided to do was then, if that immune response is actually induced, we should be able to find rice functions that are involved in perceiving the damage and in elaboration of the immune response. See, these are all experiments that we're doing in the early 2000 period. And in those days, you know, the concept of the plant innate immune system was really new. And, so we had to convince ourselves that indeed this actually is right. And it's a journey that I'll describe to you now. So what are the rice functions involved in induction of immune responses? And how does the bacterium suppress rice innate immunity? So if the bacterium is indeed secreting some proteins to suppress innate immunity, we should be able to identify these proteins. And that is something that another PhD student, Dipanvita Sinha, actually took up this work. And what Dipanvita showed is that there are four XOO proteins that suppress cell wall damage-induced rice innate immune responses. Now, by the time Dipanvita had started her work, a group in Japan had showed that this XOO bacterium secretes at least 20 different proteins into rice cells using the type 3 secretion system. So what Dipanvita did was, each of these proteins, she cloned them, and individually she added them into rice. You treat with the cell wall degrading enzyme, and you also add each of these proteins. And by going through each of these 20 proteins, what Dipanvita found was that there are four proteins that are secreted into rice using the type 3 secretion system. Each one of them can individually suppress rice innate immunity. So these proteins are called xanthomonas outer proteins. You don't need to remember what they are. They're called, you know, there are four different proteins. Each has an alphabetical name. One is N, ZOP N, ZOP Q, ZOP X, ZOP Z. Again, you don't have to remember those names. Just think that there are four of these proteins that XOO secretes that suppress rice innate immunity. Now, this is an example of how we do this assay. So this is the cell wall degrading enzyme treated rice leaves. And these are all the callose deposits that you see here. OK, Okay, that's the response, the defense response of the plant. Simultaneously, along with the cell wall degrading enzyme, if you introduce ZOPQ into rice cells, and how we introduce them, if you are interested, we can discuss later. But just think for the moment that we have the capacity to be able to introduce each of these proteins into rice cells. And when you introduce along with ZOPQ, you can see that the defense responses are very much reduced. So this is the assay that Dipanvita used to show that these four proteins, so all 20 she tried, and 16 of them absolutely the same defense response is induced whether you put the protein or not, but there are four of them which actually are suppressing rice innate immunity. So we were one step ahead in the process now. Not only did we know how it was suppressing, that it was using the type 3 secretion system, now we know that there are four proteins that go through the type 3 secretion system to suppress rice innate immunity. Now, what Dipanvita also showed is that these four proteins function in a redundant manner to suppress rice innate immunity. By mutations, she was able to generate different bacterial strains that don't have, some of them don't have one of the proteins, some don't have two, some don't have three. What she was able to show that even if there is one functional ZOP, that is sufficient to suppress innate immunity. So one of these ZOPs is enough to suppress innate immunity. Why XO has four of these ZOPs to suppress rice innate immunity, we don't know even now, but they could be working on one defense pathway at multiple points, or there may be multiple pathways, that is not really clear. But right now we know that there are four proteins that suppress rice innate immunity. So the next question was, how do these proteins suppress rice immune responses? And this was the thesis work of another PhD student, her name is Sohini Deb, who has just finished her PhD work. Now, what Sohini was able to show is that, and again, I won't go into the long story of how she actually did it, that rice has a family of proteins called 1433 proteins. These are what are called general regulatory factors. They are called general regulatory factors because they play key roles in rice signal transduction cascades. These proteins serve as adapters in a lot of signal transduction cascades in rice, not only in rice, in all eukaryotic cells. These 1433 proteins play very, very important roles in signal transduction. And rice has eight such proteins. And what Sohini found was that these ZOPs have motifs that help them bind to 1433 proteins. And she was able to show that these ZOPs interact with 5 out of 8 rice 1433 proteins. And she was also able to show that the ability to interact with 1433 proteins is crucial for XO to suppress innate immunity. So now I will tell you, there is a cell wall damage, XO suppresses them, suppresses cell wall damage using proteins that it secretes into rice cells. These rice, these proteins interact with these 1433 proteins. And that interaction is necessary for suppression of innate immunity. So the next question was, what do these 1433 proteins do in rice innate immunity? And this is work that is still ongoing. What we find is that four of these five target proteins, they appear to be positive regulators of innate immunity. And one of them has already been shown to be, in the literature, a negative regulator of rice innate immunity. So our current hypothesis is that these 1433 proteins do something for the rice innate immune system. We don't know yet what exactly the molecular role is, but we think that they are playing very important roles in elaboration of the immune system. By interaction with these proteins, the ZOPs are able to suppress the immune response. Now, while we were doing this work on the rice pathogen, a group in Israel has been working on a Xanthomonas pathogen that infects tomato and tobacco plants. So these Xanthomonas group of pathogens infect a number of plants. We work on the one that infects rice. There are things that infect other crops. This group in Israel has been working on a pathogen that infects tomato and tobacco. And there also they find that multiple ZOPs are secreted by that Xanthomonas pathogen. And they also target multiple 1433 proteins. So our current working hypothesis is that this is a general strategy that Xanthomonas pathogens have evolved, that the way to suppress rice innate immunity is to interact with these 1433 proteins. So this is sort of the simplified scheme that I was telling you earlier about for elaboration of innate immunity. There is a plasma membrane, there is a receptor there, and we think that the elicitor right now is the cell wall degradation product. That triggers a signal transduction cascade, and we think that these 1433 proteins are playing some role in this particular process. So in these multiple steps, these 1433 proteins are playing a role. And what we think is happening is that the ZOPs are interfering with these 1433 proteins. By interfering with these 1433 proteins, this signal transduction that is started by upon binding of the receptor to the elicitor, this signal transduction doesn't actually take place. Once the signal transduction doesn't take place, there is no activation of transcription factors. What these transcription factors are, I'll tell you in a little minute. So even if cell wall damage is sensed, the activation of transcription factors doesn't occur, there is no defense response, and hence there is susceptibility. Okay, so this is how the bacterium is actually, we think this is how the bacterium is able to suppress rice innate immunity. So far I've been telling you only about how the bacterium suppresses innate immunity. I haven't told you about what are the rice functions involved in elaboration of innate immunity. It's a lot of work that has been done by other PhD students in the lab, Kamal Kumar Malukani and Bipin Kumar. They have each worked, one of them has worked on a receptor kinase, which we call, it's called OS-VACL21. It's a wall-associated kinase-like protein. What it means, the jargon means is that it's a receptor that's located in the plasma membrane in close contact with the rice cell wall, and that we think that this is actually the sensor of the cell wall. Either it is a sensor or it is a co-receptor that is involved in sensing the damage to the cell wall. And Bipin has identified a transcription factor. You don't need to remember what that name is. That also plays an important role in elicitation of rice innate immunity. How do we know that these proteins are playing a role in rice innate immunity? If we overexpress this particular protein in rice, or this particular protein, either in rice or the model plant Arabidopsis, there is an induction of immune responses and enhanced tolerance to bacterial infection. So if you make more of these proteins, then there is an induction of defense responses. If we knock down these proteins, either protein, if we knock down this receptor or if we knock down this transcription factor, rice response to cell wall damage induced immune responses is very much reduced. So if we overexpress them, there is an enhanced, there is an induction of immunity. If you knock them down, then there is a reduction in innate immunity. That is why we think that these two proteins are actually involved in elaboration of innate immunity. So now I'll add a little bit more data, more meat to this particular, more substance to this model. So this is the plasma membrane. This is the receptor, and we think it is this wall-associated kinase-like protein 21. We think that it is the one that is picking up the cell wall degradation product. Either this is the receptor or it is a co-receptor, that is, it works in close conjunction with a receptor. These are located in the membrane. And we think that there are several signal transduction steps, and that is where the 1433 proteins are involved. That results in activation of transcription factors. OSRJ1, this particular transcription factor, is only one of them. We think that there are a few more. Once these transcription factors are induced, the defense response occurs and there is resistance. So what I've told you so far is this. XOO secretes cell wall degrading enzymes. That elicits an induction of there's an incipient immune response that is being elicited through action of VACL21, OSRJ1. I think 1433 proteins are involved in this process. And that the ZOPs are actually allowing XOO to suppress these immune responses. We thought this was the end of the story. We have actually figured out how, at least broadly, how this actually works. Lo and behold, we had a surprise. Now, what Dipanvita had found was that two proteins of those four that suppress immunity, this ZOPQ protein and ZOPX proteins, they interact with each other. And I won't give you details of how they interact with each other, but they do actually interact with each other. And what Sohini thought, and we had also thought naively, that each one of them can suppress immunity individually. If we add both of them together into rice, maybe they're even better suppressors of innate immunity. And to our surprise, and I'm not showing you all of that data, if you're interested, we can discuss later. What we found was that if you introduce both of these two proteins, just those two proteins by themselves, without other xanthomonas proteins being present, that elicits an even more stronger immune response. So there's an immune response that is induced by when we pit both of these two together. So what we think now is that these two proteins act together in conjunction within the rice cells, and somehow rice senses the presence of these proteins that are inside the cell. So I told you there are two layers of the plant immune system. One layer works at the cell surface, another layer works inside the cell. And these effectors that have now gone inside the cell, we think that there are some rice receptors. We don't know what they are right now, that actually recognize their presence and mounts a defense response. So the next question that Sohini did was to find out how this immune response is suppressed. Because the bacterium is causing disease. If it is causing disease, it must suppress them. So what she did was, I told you initially that there are at least 20 proteins that XO secretes into rice to suppress the, it secretes 20 of them. For four of them, we know that they suppress layer one of the plant immune system. Now she took the remaining 16, tested each one of them, and what she found was that five other T3SS effectors, again, you don't need to remember their names, but think that there are five other proteins that suppress ZOPQ, ZOPX induced immune response. So the bacterium can not only suppress the first layer of the immune response, but it can suppress the second layer of the immune response. And that's what I'm showing you here, a model here. So we think that there are two layers of the rice innate immune system, and both these layers are suppressed by cooperative action of multiple xanthomonas effectors. So the immune response that is triggered by cell wall damage, which I had referred to as pathogen-triggered immunity, or layer one of the plant immune response, that is suppressed by ZOPQ, ZOPX, and two other proteins. So if this suppression is not there, then that will result in immune response and resistance. That the bacterium is suppressing. Now, rice has learned to detect the presence of these two proteins and again mount a defense response. This defense response is suppressed by five other proteins. So this defense response is what we call effector-triggered immunity, because this is triggered by effectors that the bacterium is secreting into plant cells. So this suppression occurs. So both PTI and ETI are suppressed by the XOO bacterium because they are both able to, if either one of them, the bacterium is not able to suppress, then there is an immune response and resistance. But because this bacterium can suppress both layers of the immune response, immune suppression results in disease development. So just I'll come back here. So the first step in the interaction between the plant and the pathogen, between, in this case, the pathogen and the plant, there are virulence factors and other signals that come from the bacterium. That triggers the first layer of the plant immune response. This is called pathogen-triggered immunity. So the hypothesis is that in most plants, most pathogens that come on the plant, most potential pathogens that land on the plant surface, their growth is inhibited because of triggering of the first layer of the immune response. So the first layer of the immune response takes care of most potential pathogens. But there are pathogens that have, microbes that have learned to adapt to the plant, and they secrete certain proteins, and that's what I call suppression of PTI. That's what we talked about, the ZOPs that suppress cell wall damage induced innate immunity. So this suppression occurs. Now the bacterium is able to, ready to cause disease. This layer is also now, so the presence of these is also, actually these effectors within the plant is inducing immune responses. This is what is called effector-triggered immunity. So those pathogens that can't be taken care of by PTI, the plant immune response has this ETI, the second layer, that takes care of most of them. A few pathogens have learned to suppress both PTI and ETI, and that XOO is able to do. So XOO also is able to suppress ETI. So all of these have to be done for the pathogen to be able to cause disease on the plant. So most pathogens are taken care of by the first layer, a certain filtering occurs there. Then the second, some more pathogens are taken care of by UTI. To cause disease, essentially both have to be suppressed, and that's when disease occurs. But if this is where the story ended, then there would be no rice plant left on the planet, because the bacterium is able to suppress both layers of the immune system. Now what rice has been doing, there is intense selection going on at the level of individual pathogen isolates and individual rice cultivars, where rice is now developing what are called resistance genes. Now these resistance genes are the final layer of the plant immune system, and they are occurring within the population of the rice plant. So some rice plants have these, some others don't have. So it's an indication of ongoing selection that is occurring in the interaction between the plant and the pathogen. And it is these resistance genes that people like me are interested in, and plant breeders and plant pathologists are interested in, to develop resistant rice varieties. Okay? And now I will tell you, I'll come to the final part of my talk. So I've told you about the two layers of the plant innate immune system. I told you about how this innate immunity is modulated during infection. And now I'll tell you a little bit about development of the work we have done on development of the disease-resistant rice variety. Now, this bacterial blight is a really serious disease. And this is a rice field that is infected with the Exobacterium. Okay, it's in a place called Kurnool district in Andhra Pradesh. This Kurnool district is actually the center of cultivation of a rice variety called Samba Masuri, which is a very highly valued rice variety. Okay? And the Samba Masuri harvests in this part of India were regularly getting devastated by epidemics of bacterial blight. So the Agricultural University had requested CCMB to actually try, and because we were already working on this, they wanted us to help solve this particular problem. And the Indian Council of Agricultural Research was also interested that CCMB works with ICAR to try and combat this problem. And we worked with an organization called the Indian Institute of Rice Research, which is one of the leading rice research institutes in India, and that's also located in Hyderabad. So this Samba Masuri is a rice variety with exceptional quality characters. So it is a favorite of consumers and farmers, but it is susceptible to this disease. And the problem is that there are no effective bactericides for controlling the disease. So if the disease comes, that's essentially the end of the end of the story as far as that particular, like I showed you a previous slide. You can see the damage that this bacterium can cause. Now, this is an extreme case. It's not that every field, the whole field is affected. It depends on when in the cropping season the disease occurs, but there is substantial loss of yield. So what we first did was that we set out to understand the genetic diversity of the XOO pathogen in India. So along with the Indian Institute of Rice Research, and subsequently with a company called Bayer Crop Science, we collected the bacterium from different locations in India, looked at the genetic diversity of the pathogen. Then we determined which of the rice resistance genes, as I told you, within the rice population, within the rice varieties that are there, there are different rice resistance genes that are present. So that resistance gene is not present in all cultivars. This is a result of ongoing selection between the pathogen and the plant. So they are present in certain cultivars, but not in others. So we went through these resistance genes that had been previously identified by groups working in Japan and the Philippines. So we determined that three rice resistance genes would be effective against the Indian strains of XOO. Then we finally we worked on introducing these three resistance genes into Samba Masuri. And this is where the connection with Punjab comes in. So we had Samba Masuri, which had fine quality and was bacterial blight susceptible. There was a variety called SS1113. SS stands for Sukhvinder Singh. Dr. Sukhvinder Singh was working at that time at the Punjab Agricultural University, and he was working in collaboration with the International Rice Research Institute in the Philippines. So what Dr. Sukhvinder Singh and the IRI group had done was that these three BB resistance genes, they had assembled them into a background of a rice variety called PR106, Punjab rice cultivar 106. But this particular variety, SS1113, never really took off because its quality was not good. And subsequently, Punjab Agricultural University had developed better rice varieties that they worked on to ultimately make them also bacterial blight resistant. But what Dr. Sukhvinder Singh did was he was kind enough to share the seeds of this particular variety with us. So in conjunction with the Indian Institute of Rice Research, we worked on, and I won't go into how we actually made this crossing scheme. It is what is called backcross breeding and marker-assisted selection. If you're interested, we can discuss what it, how that was done. But we came up with a variety called improved Samba Masuri, which has fine quality, high yield, and is bacterial blight resistant. And what was important is that we went back to that same area in Karnool where these epidemics were occurring. So this is a hotspot of the disease, a place where if the variety is susceptible, it doesn't stand a chance. It is going to get infected. So several years, these have actually been grown there. Now this is Samba Masuri. It just turns out that we had coincidentally, we had two farms. One farm was cultivating Samba Masuri, another was improved Samba Masuri. So foreground is improved Samba Masuri, background is Samba Masuri. And I hope that people can see that the Samba Masuri rice plants were actually dried up. You know, the bacterial disease had actually caused drying up of the field, and the farmer actually burnt that crop because he didn't even want to spend money to actually harvest that because he was not going to get anything. But right next to it is this improved Samba Masuri that is perfectly healthy and gave proper yield. So cumulatively, it has been grown, we think, this is an underestimate, but at least 700,000 hectares of farmers' fields in seven different states of India. This improved Samba Masuri is grown. And the total produce from this is estimated to be around 6,700 crores. And what is actually called the trait value? The trait value is, if somebody is growing Samba Masuri instead of improved Samba Masuri, what is the difference in the time, in the amount of value that they have got? If you grow improved Samba Masuri instead of Samba Masuri, what is the value you get? And this is an independent estimate done by another institute under the Ministry of Agriculture. And what they estimate, the estimate is that there is a trait value of about 1290 crores. That means this is money that has come to the farmers only because they have grown improved Samba Masuri instead of Samba Masuri. So we were very happy that we were able to solve a problem that is related to that particular area of the country. But this Samba Masuri is grown in multiple parts of India, and the variety is actually being grown. And in many of these places, bacterial blight is a problem, and the variety is being grown there. Now, what is also being done, we are also doing it in conjunction with the Indian Institute of Rice Research, is to further improve improved Samba Masuri. We are putting in traits for drought, we are putting in traits for fungal disease resistance, for higher yield, for the ability to combat, these are coastal states, and the bacterium, they're subjected to cyclonic weather, etc. We're trying to help them combat those also. So I'll come to the end of my talk. What I want to tell you is that the outcome of the interaction between plants and potential pathogens revolves around two points. The ability of the plant to sense presence of the pathogen and mount a defense response. So the plant should be able to sense the pathogen and mount a defense response. Then it's the ability of the pathogen to suppress host immune responses. So both of these two must actually occur. The take-home message is that there has been a continuous battle of punching and counter-punching during the evolution of plant-pathogen interactions. And the interacting partner that lands the last punch is the winner. And often, this is determined at the level of the genotypes of individual pathogen isolates and plant varieties. These are a lot of people who have worked with me over the years. I've only talked about the people who are currently working in the lab or who have just graduated. So there is a group working at suppression of rice innate immunity. I was at NIPGR for a few years, and so part of this work was also done at NIPGR. Then induction of rice innate immunity, there's another group. We have a group working on cell wall degrading enzymes. What are their properties? How do they induce immune responses? And there are other projects on how the bacterium adapts to stressful conditions. the development of novel rice resistant varieties, there are actually a lot of people in the group whom I have not included, and collaborators at CCMB, Dr. Shankar Narayanan, with whom we collaborated on structure solution of these receptors and how that helps us understand the pathogenesis process. And then Dr. Sirish Tiwari and his group, we work on using bioinformatics and next generation sequence analysis to develop even newer rice varieties. And at Gopalji Jha and Jyoti Lakshmi at NIPGR. And right here in Chandigarh, Prabhu Patel and his students at IMTEC. I have not talked about his work, but he's doing now a lot of innovative work on how virulence mechanisms are evolving, how they're developing in this exopathogen, as well as other xanthomonas that infect plants. And our collaborators at Indian Institute of Rice Research, a lot of them, Sundaram, Laha, Mutharaman and Seshu Madhav and others, and D.O. Mishra at BioCrop Science. So I thank you for your attention.
Professor Sundi, would you like to take a few questions from
the
audience?
Sure, please.
Sure. Any questions?
Professor Sundi, is there an accompanying study of how the nutritional value of these varieties changes?
I think, is it from my side or? Maybe I should stay here. What I didn't mention to you earlier is that we have looked at the quality characteristics of both Sambar Masuri and improved Sambar Masuri, and they're identical to each other. Okay, both Sambar Masuri and improved Sambar Masuri have what is called low GI content. Low GI basically means that low glycemic index. That means they're good for diabetics. So that's another plus point about definitely improved Sambar Masuri, but we think that the low glycemic character of improved Sambar Masuri is coming from Sambar Masuri. Thank you. I'll tell you both of them. The first point is that I told you that there are three resistance genes that we have introduced. One of them is actually a gene that has come from wild rice. Okay, this wild rice is called Oryza longistaminata, and I think it was from somewhere in Africa, northern Africa. Okay, it originated from there, went to the Central Rice Research Institute in Cuttack, it's now called the National Rice Research Institute in Cuttack, where they showed that that particular wild rice was very, very tolerant to bacterial infection. That from there it went to the International Rice Research Institute, where they actually transferred that gene from there into the cultivated rice. And a group in the United States actually cloned that resistance gene. Now what we are actually looking for is a marker, that is DNA marker that is close to that gene, and that is enough for us to be able to transfer it in a cross between a variety that has that into Sambar Masuri. So yes, wild rices have, they are an untapped reservoir of resistance genes along with other traits that can be beneficial in agriculture. So it's very important to conserve biodiversity, number one point. The second point is that, yes, we are actually being involved in a program. Now it has been, when I was at CCMB, we were doing it. Subsequently also, this program is going on, where we have been distributing these seeds as small seed packets of about 10 kg to farmers in 7 different states of India. I think so far we have given to about 10,000 farmers. They are like our brand ambassadors. We give the seed to them and we tell them how to grow the variety, and they grow it, and when they are happy with it, then they can actually spread the seed to other farmers. Yeah. So we are doing some of that. But one of the things is that we need to actually scale up the production of these seeds so that they reach a larger group of beneficiaries.
So my question is also about the last part, the resistance genes of rice, right, which is your the topmost layer, as it were. Do we know how they function? And secondly, is there an evolutionary cost to the rice plant to carry these genes?
Yeah, good point, Shankar. As I said, the first one is from that wild rice, and that wild rice, that particular gene appears to be a part of the layer one of the plant immune system. It's a receptor kinase, and it recognizes a peptide that the Exobacterium secretes into the medium. And it looks like that peptide may be used in intercellular communication between the bacteria. We don't know whether that is the case or the peptide does something to the rice plant. Okay? But that receptor actually recognizes that particular peptide. So layer one of the plant immune system is triggered, and the bacterium, Exobacterium, has not figured out how to suppress it. So that's the first one. The other two resistance genes are actually, there's a category of resistance that I have not talked about. And that category actually belongs to what are called susceptibility genes. So all plants actually have not only resistance genes, they are what are called susceptibility genes. These are genes that are present in the plant, and their presence actually makes the plant susceptible to infection. So in the Exobacterium, what it does is that it secretes as part of the, using the type 3 secretion system, that type 3 secretion system has two roles. One is to suppress the immune response. The second role, it turns out, which I have not covered, is that there are certain proteins that are going through the secretion system. These are different from the ZOPs. These proteins serve as transcription factors that, for example, they upregulate expression of a sucrose transporter. Okay? And we think that, and the general feeling in the field is that, that sucrose transporter secretes, pumps out the sugar. We think it is sucrose that pumps out from the bacterial cell, from the plant cell, out into the extracellular space so that the bacterium can feed on it. So that is one of the ways in which the bacterium gets nutrients. And if you remove the ability, if you make the rice plant unresponsive to this transcription factor that is coming from the bacterium, that gives, again, contributes to resistance. So we assembled a bunch of these, and together they give resistance. So yeah, and the part about whether there is a cost, yes, we think that there is a cost, because this particular susceptibility gene, it is being used by the bacterium to actually get nutrients, but it has some other role within the plant in terms of probably exchange of sucrose between plant cells. There is a reduction in the amount of pollen that is produced in the mutations in this susceptibility factor. Okay? But the amount of pollen that is being produced is fairly high, and rice is a self-pollinating crop, so it doesn't really affect the yield of rice varieties. In hybrids, where there are reports that the presence of this gene, where you actually have to cross two particular varieties to get the product, to get the hybrid, there are some reports that suggest that there can be a deficiency there. There's a slight effect on yield because of the presence of this mutation, but generally people feel that yes, it can affect the growth of the plant, but it is not strong enough to actually make any major difference to the yield. So there is enough compensation in terms of the yield that is saved by resistance against pathogen attack.
Any more questions?
I think there was a question.
So very nice, great work, very impactful work. So I have a general question, and I would like to know your thoughts on recently developed techniques like spread breeding, as well as, because this back crossing to get a nearly isogenic line with the desired trait takes years and very tedious, laborious work, right? And your thoughts on CRISPR-Cas9 technique, how we can speed up, and considering the anti-GM lobbies and so on. So
It would be really great to hear from you.
So there are two aspects to this question. The first part is, yes, four back crosses, you know, there's a four back crosses takes a lot of time. Okay, what speed breeding does is that it reduces the generation time of a particular plant, so that instead of taking 145 days to go from seed to seed, you can essentially do it much faster. So in a given year, you can pack more, you know, the breeding cycle actually gets hastened up, because instead of two generations in a year, maybe you can take four generations in a year. So instead of what can maybe take 3 years, you can now do it in 1.5 years. So speed breeding is very important, you know, but that protocol for speed breeding has to be developed for each crop. So for rice, an efficient speed breeding protocol needs to be developed. I think NABI and maybe Punjab Agricultural University are working on that. The second point as to what is the what is my take on CRISPR-Cas9 as a technological solution. To me, the mutations made through CRISPR-Cas9, and particularly one particular aspect of the CRISPR technology, where mutations are made within the plant genome without adding any new genes. Okay, so these are genes that through CRISPR you can knock out a particular, you can make a modification in a particular part of the rice genome. There is no gene added there. Now that particular CRISPR-derived variety is no different from any variety developed through classical breeding. So I don't really see any real problems with respect to adoption. In my opinion, CRISPR-Cas9 derived rice varieties should be accepted as well as traditionally bred rice varieties. For transgenics, of course, there is a regulatory protocol that needs to be followed, and once that regulatory protocol is followed and it is determined to be safe, I think it should be also safe.
Any more questions?
But you know, the solution of choice is take marker-assisted selection. If that won't give you a solution, then you go for transgenesis.
Sir, my question to you is, you said that there are resistance genes at the last of the presentation that are enough to resist the pathogens. But in course of evolution, if we see the thing that bacteria can evolve a lot, there are might be some mutations in the strains of the bacteria that can induce much more pathogenicity to the plant or the host. So what's your take on that? Are these sufficient for the resistance?
That's a very good point.
And one more question. You said about the back crossing, which you discussed right now, and also the marker assistant selection that are required to produce the transgenic crop or the hybrid variety that it needs to be produced. So can you please detail a bit about what is marker assisted selection?
Yeah. So first, the first part is the resistance going to be sustainable? And this comes back to what Professor Gauri Shankar was asking. I told you that one of the resistance genes recognizes a peptide that comes from the bacterium, and that triggers the layer one of the immune response. There are already Xanthomonas XOO strains in India that no longer produce that particular peptide. And these are now, they are able to cause disease, or they are able to break down the resistance caused by the by that receptor kinase. So if we had just one gene, by now, you know, if we had just one, that one resistance gene, by now it would have broken down. What we have done is we put three different resistance genes, and this is the work that we have done in conjunction with the Biocrop Science. Between Biocrop Science, Indian Institute of Rice Research, and CCMB, we have probably looked at now about 1,300 XOO strains from different locations in India and inoculated them into rice varieties that have all the three genes present. There are varieties that can break down each one of these resistance genes. There are XOO strains that can break them down. But we have not found any yet that can break down all three of them. Okay? So far there is nothing that has come. It is not to say that it won't happen in the future. So what is being done, and this is work done again at Punjab Agricultural University and at the Indian Institute of Rice Research. Additional genes from wild rices and from what are called land races that were grown in India earlier, they are being introgressed into the cultivated rice backgrounds to form additional genes that can be incorporated if the need arises. But I suppose the right thing would be to actually think that these will break down and move, basically what we did with improved Sambar Mussari, do it with some of these newer genes. Now, the other part about what marker-assisted selection is, when we did this work, we didn't really know what these genes were doing. We just knew that they were effective and that there is a DNA marker that is tightly linked to them. So what we do, we took SS1113, we took Sambar Mussari, and we crossed the two together. Okay? And there are DNA markers that are diagnostic. It's like a PCR test for, I wouldn't say COV2, but it's like a DNA test because that's an RT-PCR test, but this is just a regular PCR. You get a particular size fragment if there is resistance, a different size fragment if there is susceptibility. Okay? So we can cross SS1113 to Sambar Mussari and then follow the DNA markers to find out in each step of the backcross breeding program which are the plants that have the resistance genes. The second thing we did was we didn't want the SS1113 genome because that had the genes that were not for good quality. And Sambar Mussari, it is not going to be accepted by farmers if the quality is not there. So we devised a selection scheme where we also looked at DNA markers that are diagnostic of the Sambar Mussari genome. So you use DNA tests to look for presence of the resistance gene and DNA tests to look for presence of the Sambar Mussari genome. And you keep doing that over four backcross generations so that ultimately you get a plant that has the three resistance genes from SS1113 and 96% of the genome comes from Sambar Mussari. So that was actually what improved Sambar Mussari.
Any more questions? If there are no further questions, please join me in applauding Professor Somti for such a wonderful lecture. This is a small memento from ISR Mohali. Thank you, Professor Somti.
Thank you.
We have come to the end of today's program. It is a pleasure for me to propose a vote of thanks. On behalf of ISR Mohali, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to our chief guest, Professor Ramesh Somti, for taking time off from his hectic schedule and coming all the way from Tirupati to be with us today in person for the Foundation Day lecture. Thank you so much. I thank all our guests for accepting our invitation and joining us either in person or online. For the last several weeks, many of us were involved in planning and making arrangements for today's event, starting from our Director, Professor Gaurishankar, Deputy Director, Professor Sudeshna Sinha, Registrar, Professor Jagdeep Singh, Dean Outreach, Professor Prasad, faculty colleagues, Dr. Amit Kulshreshtha and Dr. Nirja. I thank each one of you in coordinating this event. I thank Dr. Paramdeep and the staff of ISR Mohali Computer Center, especially Mr. Ramshankar and Mr. Imtiaz, for their assistance in recording and streaming this event. I thank the administrative staff, Mr. Sandeep Ahlawat, Mr. Mukesh Kumar, and their team, the Institute Works Department, Executive Engineer, Mr. Srivastava and his team, and Dean R&D Office Assistant, Mr. Anuj, for providing us with all possible logistical support towards organizing this program. Most importantly, I would like to thank all the student volunteers for their assistance in today's event. Thank you all for your participation. Wish you a great evening ahead.
milestone.